Welcome to ATCM, the Emergency Medicine Channel. Today we'll be discussing on how to approach a disaster right at the hospital, right at the scene, and also at the hospital. Can we begin, sir?
So we had a recent disaster that came into our ED. So we'll be discussing on that basis. That is a discussion all about. So it's a little bit different from the routine case presentation. So it is definitely meant for all the emergency room or whoever is a registered medical practitioner. In a day in your life, you will be encountering a disaster. So at that time, how to go about it and how we will plan it and what are the steps involved in a disaster preparedness and disaster management. That is what we are going to do. A multiple casualty or a mass casualty, how will you deal about it? So you can start.
Yeah. So sir, a couple of days back, we received a call stating that there was a fire that broke out at a nearby building and we were supposed to expect a couple of casualty. Now we were dealing with a mass casualty and we were going to go about on how to plan and prepare the entire team.
Okay. So the first thing that you were intimated by someone that a fire has broken down in the nearby building and you are expecting a patient inflow from that incidence and you were in the duty in the ED. So that was the history that you got. Okay. So at this point, what are the key things that you need to do?
So, sir, to begin with, first, it could be a misinformation, which is why we need to cross-verify this incident.
Okay.
So, the first, our priority is to verify that such an incident has happened and that we will be expecting a more number of casualty, and that also depends again on what is the expected casualties that we will be expecting.
Okay.
Basically, if it is a mass casualty, then it will overwhelm the resources that we currently run the ER on, and that it will be a call to call in more number of people.
So the first thing that you cross check that whether the information that you received is right or wrong. Many a times it will be difficult because you can get a call and after that you will not be able to trace that call. Mm-hmm. Since the incident happened nearby, you can maybe ask the nearby police station or nearby somebody that you know or somebody major area, you can call up and confirm the information.
Mm-hmm.
So that way we can get this information right. But many a time it can be a fake information also. So the false alarms can also be happen. But whatever be the situation, we should be prepared to receive in number of patients. So what is the thing that you need to tell them? Suppose you receive a call in the ED like this, that it is a confirmed disaster. So like what information that you need to share with the party that is going to send the patient? Maybe the police person or the fire rescuer is calling you and he is telling that he is going to send you patients. So what information that you can give him?
Sir, in this situation, there will be like certain terms that has to be used, like that. Let's just say if it's a major incident, there is a major incident standby, major incident declared. So if it's a standby, it means to say that we should be expecting that such an incident has happened and that we will be expecting casualties.
Okay.
So standby means that we should be prepared with the external assistance and all the other
Suppose
resources.
Suppose it is declared.
So once it is declared, then the whole thing we'll have to address, we'll have to anticipate the issues that we will be facing. One major drawbacks or challenges that we will face during a mass casualty is one, poor communication. And second will be patients high staffed, so it will be difficult to control the crowd.
Okay, that is all fine. But the first information that you should be passing him is that what is your capacity right now? How many patients you will be able to take now? Suppose there is a building fire and they are sending like 50 patients to you. Will you be able to manage those 50 patients? So what is the capacity for you right now? Maybe already your ED will be having patients. So whatever your disaster beds, you can have n number of beds that is ready for your disaster management. Maybe suppose we have, for example, we are ED has got a 50 bedded ED and ED is almost 95% full during this event. So we only have like 5% extra 10 beds. You just keep it that we are only having a 10 beds. Suppose the other person is going to send in you like 20 to 25 patients. So what will you do? So that information that you need to clearly tell him. So how much critically ill you will be able to manage at that point, because there are, all the hospitals are in and around the center is there. So they need to divert this patient like a way so that a red category patient should not be wasting in time when there is no bed is available. So clear that information should be very clearly given to that person who is going to send in you patients. Suppose you have a capacity of 10 patients, you can tell Maybe you can move some stable patients also from the ED, and maybe you can have some 15 to 20. That is the maximum capacity maybe at that point of time. It all depends upon what is the patient's present status. Mm. So the first idea will be what is our capacity right now. Mm. So depending upon that capacity, whether it will be a multiple casualty or it can be a mass casualty also. For example, we have got 10 beds available. So 5 patients coming in together following an RTA will be a multiple casualty. When our surge capacity is more than what is required, then only we need to call it as a mass casualty. So, in this situation, what was the scenario? So, what was the communication that you received?
So, sir, in this, once we get to know about this, like you mentioned, we'll have to get to know how bad the disaster is, the impact of the disaster,
okay. And
also on the capacity of our hospital. So, once that is met, we can categorize this whole as a category 1 and a category 2 thing. One, that is, the disaster is so massive that the ongoing ER patients as such has to be stopped, and that the beds have to be cleared to receive the patient.
So all the existing services you need to stop and you need to take care of this patient. Mm-hmm. or else
the second one will be that the patient can be brought in. The ER as such, the functioning of the ER will be impacted, but you don't have to suddenly stop all the functions. So can
the routine
accommodate.
Patients can come in. You can take care of the patients who have come with the disaster also.
Disaster.
So that's what I said, depending upon your capacity. You have to decide. So if you are receiving, like during that time, I said 10 beds were vacant, you are receiving 7 to 8 patients, it will just be a mass casualty, but you need to manage the other patient also. Maybe it will be category 2. If we like 50 patients is going to come in, it will be a category 1. Then what is category 3?
In category 3, that is like in-hospital
it
disaster.
It is an internal incident.
Within the hospital.
The other two are the external incident. So when an internal incident happens, you totally have to shut down everything and you need to take care of that.
Yeah.
So that is an internal incident, that is category 3. Category 1, you need to stop the existing services and you need to act for the disaster. Mm. Category 2, ongoing disaster, ongoing management can be done, but there will be some impact to that, some compromise will be there and you need to take in those group of patients. Mm. So these are the categories that you need to remember. Mm. So once your information passed on, like I have got like 10 beds available for your patients and we can receive this many number of patients.
Yeah.
And you can also ask for the number, because many times the person there also is not very sure how many people were there inside the fire accident. They are not sure. So it will be very difficult sometimes to get that information, but definitely we can tell what is our capacity right now and how many patients we will be able to cater. So sometimes this all will not work because in our system there is no proper disaster planning and preparedness. So this can all go for a toss. So what exactly we need to plan is that what is our capacity, and depending upon the capacity, how many more we can receive and how many more patients we can move from our ED, that we need to discuss.
So sir, in this particular situation, the crucial thing will be a proper communication, not just within the hospital or the staff, but also between the ED and the scene. So we will get to know the number of casualties that we will be taking, and also the communication within the hospital where we communicate with the staff, nurses, the medical managers, the administration, everything has to be involved in this.
So now we'll just go through the time loop as such. So we have received a call and you have informed the person that this many number of patients I can receive.
Mm.
And he is requesting for an EMS also to be dispatched from the center.
Mm.
So you have alerted your EMS team and the EMS team with an EMT is ready to go to the scene and rescue the patient and bring him to your ED.
Mm.
So at this point, what are the functions that an EMS team should be taking care of?
Sir, in this scene, one would be a scene safety.
Mm.
So the first thing would be the priority of the particular individual, which is why patient has to or EMS people have to approach the scene once scene safety is achieved and with proper protective equipments. So once that is achieved and we take in casualties, the most common way of controlling the crowd would be the salt triage, which basically stands for sorting, wherein in sorting we announce all the walk, we categorize the patient as walkers, walkers, waiters, and still patients. Walkers are those who can move around and clear the way. So basically, they're not that very sick. The waiting people are the people who cannot move and they will require immediate intervention. And then those are the still patients that are moribund patients, wherein they
are not
very,
very sure. They might be salvageable or they might not be salvageable. They are already dead. We are not very sure. So those group of patients, we are not very sure.
Mm-hmm.
So our attention should be given to the patient who is still and unresponsive. So those group of, just like your AVPU scoring, the alert patients will move around. You ask them to move around to a safe area, they will move. Then the category is, next is the verbal response, then painful and unresponsive group of victims. Just like your AVPU score, the P and U, you have to be very cautious and you need to rescue them first from the scene.
So in this situation, the walkers will be the least of the priority for now. So once we will go and we have triaged it as a basic thing as waiters and still patients, now the second thing of the SALT triage will be the assessment, wherein we will see how bad the patient is. And for field triage, the most commonly used one, as we all know, is red, yellow, black, red, yellow, green and black. Black is for moribund patients, wherein they will eat up our resources and not.
Black will be mostly like a dead patient. You can go. You can go for a blue coat. Sometimes you can tell it as blue coat. That is like a moribund, non-salivable group of patients.
So the red patients are the one that will require immediate intervention, and they will have life-threatening emergencies in them. That can be like tension pneumothorax, a cardiac tamponade, whatever.
See, it will be. In this scenario, it's a burn. It's a burn injury. So you can have different sort of burns. It can be a blast. It can be inhalation injury. It can be severe burns. Or somebody, what happened in this, somebody have jumped out of that building to get himself saved. So those sort of a trauma also can happen. So it can be multiple things. We are not very sure what exactly is happening. Okay.
So that would, those categories will be the left life threatening and has to be immediately intervened. So the next part would be the yellow category, which can be seen later once the life threat.
So depending upon their disease, delayed and immediate, you can decide whether they have to be immediately shifted to the hospital or it can be delayed shifting to the hospital. So that will be the role of EMS. So once the EMS reaches, I'll just go through the scenario again. So once the EMS reaches, what they can do immediately, do something called as a windshield survey. So what they can just look through the windshield. So in this scenario, they are sure that there is a building that is catching up on fire. They can do immediately, rather than entering into the scene, something called as a windshield survey. Just from the windshield of the ambulance, they can have a look at the scenario. If at the scenario and they find it safe, they can come out and do the scene safety, then go ahead and start. They might be involved in evacuation process also. Sometimes they should be helping the evacuation. There should be, ideally, the firefighters and all those things should be evacuating. Sometimes they need to be involved in the evacuation of the patient also, and they need to immediately do a triaging at the scene. And usual scenario, if for example your field hospital, you need to sometimes set a field hospital there itself, because of the, if the tertiary treatment center or a treatment center is very far away, like 10-20 kilometers, if you are not intervening that patient at that point of time, he might die. So you need to set up sometimes a field hospital also. So that is another major crisis that you can have. But here it was just 1 kilometer away, they could be immediately rushed to the center. So they can either stay and play, that is, they can stay and manage the patient, or scoop and run. So these are the two things that they can do. They can just scoop the patient and run to the hospital. So here most probably they would have done a scoop and run, because the center is just 2 minutes far away, and whatever life threatening is there, they can do inside the ambulance. But if the center is very far away, then you need to do the primary resuscitation at the scene itself. Then after that, you need to do the shifting. So these are the challenges that EMS will be facing. And also the one most important thing is decontamination. So in this situation, it is not, there is no hazardous spillage or anything. Sometimes it's a chemical factory that has gotten hazardous materials and it has got into an explosion, or it can be a burn. So the decontamination is also should be done. So in front of your triage area, we should have a triage area sorted out. Before that, you should be decontaminating all the patients that you are going to receive. So decontamination, again, different types of decontamination. You need to do a surface decontamination. So it all depends upon what is the exposure that you have received. And from the decontamination area, this patient should be moving to the triage. And from the triage to the ambulance, delayed or immediate, depending upon that. So this was happened, and how many patients we came in during that time?
We had roughly about 10-12 patients.
10-12 patients. We got an initially history that more number of patients are going to come, but only 10-12 patients came into our ED.
So we'll
just see this patient. The EMS personnel is bringing one patient by one to you. So let us keep on hold. Now we will go back to your phone call. So you have received a phone call and you have communicated this and you have sent your EMS. Now the time loop is that EMS person has gone to rescue the patient and come. And what are the additional things in the ED that you need to do?
Sir, in the ED, one, since we have no much idea about the casualty, so since it's a fire that broke out in our neighborhood, so it becomes our responsibility to receive as many patients as possible. So at this point in time, we raised an alarm for a mass casualty, we paged yellow, and this we categorized it as a category 1 disaster, which is why we stopped the ongoing hospital functioning of the ED, shifted all the existing CPTs.
You said it was a category 1 or a category 2?
In this case, it was a category 2, sir, because we only received 12 patients, so we could also manage the existing patients. But at present, we had separated all the patients to one area.
So, what we have done initially is that we had a plan, we have a disaster plan in our hospital. That's how it worked, because we have got enough mongrels and we have made a plan when such a disaster happened, what needed to be done. So, the most important part of any disaster management is disaster preparedness. So, we had a proper disaster preparedness plan available and what needed to be done when you receive a call like this. So, as per the standards, we have got something called as a code yellow, where we will paste code yellow. That means an external disaster has happened and the hospital is going to receive n number of patients. So, all the facilities should be concentrating on to that disaster management. So, that is a code yellow why we have paid. So, we have enough mongrels for that. So, all the team members starting from a custodial department, pharmacy department to the medical administration is involved in this. So, each one of the member of each area, like a pharmacy department, blood bank, you can have a multiple trauma patient, you have the patient movement services, you have the laboratory. So, all the services that is inside the hospital will be alerted and they will be coming for your extra help. And also, you will be getting extra doctors from the other department. So, what we have made like that, the doctors like who is from the neurosurgery, general surgery, for all other department needed to be rushed to the ED so that we can get enough hands. Because at that point of time, only one or two doctors will be on duty. So, when we have an external disaster where we are going to have more number of patients, we need more hands. So, that will be all pooled together to your ED. So, that is our disaster. We have a proper disaster plan. And we have also got a clear-cut roles and responsibilities. Because roles and responsibilities is the next most important thing. You have a huge crowd coming in without of any help. That also can happen. But roles and responsibility assigning to each of your team members is very important. So that should not be done at that point. You should have a clear-cut delineation. So which all beds will be managed by this person? And what is the job of a security staff? What is the duty of a PRO? Because already there are few patients lying down here. So their bystanders will get panic. So whether they are getting any attention, whether they are still sick, whether any doctors is attending them. So, this communication needed to be passed to them. That they are safe, we are taking care of them. So, we have to alert our existing patient and whoever is stable, we need to move them to the safer area. So, that is the first step. And you have given roles and responsibility, clear roles and responsibility. And you should form an incident command station inside the department. So, there is a one person who will be the team leader and he will be the command leader and he will be directing what to be done. So, that is the incident command center. From there, the roles and responsibility will be divided. So, the roles and responsibility, like this many patient, already existing patient, one of them have to take care. There should be adequate staff nurses. Those who are coming from other department should be given a roles and responsibilities like that. So, that is the most important part. You can have a crowd, but that crowd might be more trouble for you sometimes. They will not be doing anything. They will be just creating an chaos there. So, that should be avoided. So, that is the next thing that you have done here.
So, sir, in our hospital, the minute we got to know about the EMS people, what we did, one was, like you mentioned, we paged yellow. And then all the existing patients, we moved on to one side. And then since we had a plan prepared for this, we alerted the administration department and also the other.
This will be automatically done. We need not call each one of them.
There's
a paging system. You have to tell paging code yellow. They will be alerted that all the, from the medical admin to the top of your medical admin to the custodial to the most lowest category also will be informed.
So, since our ED resources were overwhelmed and external assistance was asked for, so once this paging was done, immediately we alert. The next thing that we have to do is basically in the whole child, we have to address the challenges, that anticipate the challenges rather. One, after communication, that there will be more staffed will be there. So, there will be a lot of confusion and chaos that will be created. So, that is also another challenge. And also the loved ones of the casualties that come in also will create a thing. So, we have to tighten our security to begin with right from outside the ER. So, once the security is tightened and we take in the patients inside, right from the gate of the or the door of the emergency department, triaging has to be done.
So, you need to have a triaging system.
Triaging system.
So, there will be a triaging done by your EMO staff. But you need to, when the patient is coming back, hospital, again, you need to retriage this group of patients. So maybe a red category has become more severe, or a yellow has become turned red, or maybe initially it was, they thought to be red, now it is yellow or green. These things can happen. So retriaging is very important. Now, again, in the retriaging, you can go with the standard, your triaging score, you can look for your vitals, and you can have a triaging chart, and you can band them according to their category.
So we have many scales, sir. Manchester Triad Scale is also one of them that we also popularly use, wherein we take in the red, orange, yellow, green and blue. Basically, life-threatening, emergent, urgent, less urgent, standard and non-urgent patients. So once that triaging is done and patients are brought in, the entire idea is to have command system, wherein we have a gold command system, a silver command system, wherein gold command system are, that includes all the senior members, and they are the communication command. So they will deal with all the communications and decide who gets to do what. The second is the silver command system, which will comprise of the senior physical physicians, senior nursing supervisors and all of it. And they are the troubleshooters of the
disaster
management. So whatever problems that come in, they have to troubleshoot it and resolve it. Communication will be dealt by, above them would be the gold command. So this third part would be the operational command, wherein the entire idea is a control and command, wherein we make teams, and each team will have a situational team leader, and those team leaders will provide each one with their individual job, so there wouldn't be much confusion, and not one person will run for everything. So that will be, that chaos thing will be dealt with.
The most important thing, that what I meant is, if you don't have all those systems, don't remove it, clear roles and responsibilities. If you don't have like one doctor, one, it is very difficult to take care of 12 patients. You might be having three doctors with you. So you need to have who is going to take care of that red category, the yellow category. You have clear roles and responsibilities, and they should not be intermixing. So that is the most important thing. You should not be running away from one thing. That's a common thing that can happen in a busy ED when something happens like this. Once you are asking for a drug, five people are running behind to take that drug. So for that team member, they should be very clear what is their role and responsibility. And we had enough number of staff actually during that time. We had enough hands. We thought like we are going to get like 20 to 30 patients, but we got only 10 to 12 patients. 12 patients we got in. So we had enough to handle like 50 patients. When we have received 50 patients, we were ready to receive that. So that was the advantage of a preparedness, a proper having a disaster mock drills and disaster preparedness. That helped us actually during that scenario. So once the patient receives, then the management is straightforward. You, depending upon the severity, you categorize them to priority 1, priority 2 and priority 3. Then you triage them and you do the necessary treatment. So that part will happen. Somebody, but the main problem is that whom you should be utilizing the major amount of your energy. You should not be wasting your whole resources for a yellow category or a green category patient. So somebody in the red category who is not responding should not be missed. So the retriaging and again directing them is the key here.
So in our case, since it was a fire that broke out, we were expecting patients to come in with inhalational burns. We were expecting patients to have fallen from the height in an attempt to jump out. And we were also expecting the rescuers who went inside the building to rescue the patients.
They got injured. Okay.
So we were suspecting lacerations and all kind of injuries. So right from the door of the ED, we triaged these patients. So one
so
of the
how
major,
many we had red category?
We had three red categories and
to the yellow we had
the two yellows.
Two yellow category and the rest were green.
So then in that, out of that yellow category was an inhalational burn, which
later
we
later on into a red category.
So we intubated this patient in view of inhalation
and somatic injury. So that's fine. So, that's a management is fine. Now what we are discussing here is the only how you prepared for the disaster and how the disaster was managed.
So this triaging, apart from this triaging, if we allot the roles, it was easy for us to manage, because even when the high staffs were like coming in, the other doctors from the department, we were able to direct which doctor gets to go to which patient and bed number.
You should have a job card. That is a roles and responsibility rather than what you can design in your ED is that you can have something like a box. When a disaster comes, you just open that and each one of you can take a card out of it. So that will be the job card for you. So what is the basic necessary? You can have a pack of 20 patients coming in. You need to get prepared. You can have job cards and maybe a disaster cupboard. What we have in our ED, we have all the extra resources that been kept inside. So we have enough IV cannulas, you have IV fluids, So all those materials. So we have a separate disaster cupboard where we are keeping these things. We are where we are not routinely using that.
So in our case, we opened the disaster cupboard and our resources just exponentially, we were able to procure as and when we needed
it. And again, the resource will be one of the greatest challenge. But we didn't face that challenge during this time because we just had 12 patients. Suppose imagine like 60 patients, then resources challenge is going to be a huge challenge here. So utilization of the resources should be very important. It is not like we have resources, let us utilize it. You should not be of that. If it is genuinely required, then only you should be utilizing the disorder. Mm-hmm. From a small gauze onwards, an IV cannula onwards, a blood products onwards, and IV fluid onwards. So all the resources should be used when it is really needed.
So the idea is to one, assess the capacity, first the fire access.
So you have declared a disaster. A disaster has happened and it was not standby. You have declared a disaster. And once it is settled, you have to close it also. That is also very important because there are other patients in. There are other service of the hospital has to run. So maybe after 1-1.5 hours, we have closed the disaster and all the patients were stabilized and moved to certain area, separate area, and we have closed the disaster. And what else do you need to do?
Sir, before we close the department, close the disaster, we close it only when either our resources are met with the number of casualties and we think it is the situation is under control. That's when we close the disaster. And closing the disaster, we would have properly categorized the patients and all the patients were fine. We will put them to one side and then we close the disaster.
And so we have to do a debriefing.
Debriefing. So in that, we go out to the individual patients, bystanders and family, and also provide them with
what exactly happened.
Yeah.
And maybe we should be prepared for a media also. So we should have a clear statement of how many patients of what age groups. So there are a lot of other challenges, like we need to have a medical record. Record number in an hospital where you have the computerized system. Without a medical record number, they will not be able to take an X-ray.
So
we will not be able to know their details and all. So we have made a plan similarly that we can have like 1, 2, 3 XYZ name, and we can get that MRD number out, and we can start doing the process for this all this patient, and then only the X-ray or any investigation that you need to send. Majority of the time, we will not be able to know the name of the patient, age of the patient, all the demographic details will not be available. So we have that made in our plan also. So as this public relation officer have done all those things, and we have made the MRD cards for all those patients that have come in, and everything was handled very smoothly.
Yeah, so we did have a separate team which ran parallelly, which took care of the documentation part, wherein we procured the patient's details and we
And again, it's a medical legal case. Again, it's going to be a medical legal case. So we involve the CFME unit, and we need to have all the wounds to be marked. The wound certificate will be issued. So all those things, we had the help of the CFME clinical forensic medicine unit. So they were also involved. So it's just a teamwork. It's not an individual that is doing a disaster. It's a teamwork. Everyone was involved, and finally, we had a very good. Disaster management outcome. At that point of time, we had a very good outcome, and all the patients were saved out of this. Even the red categories were all recovered, the intubated patient also got extubated and she was fine. Okay, so what is the learning point in this?
Learning point is one, once we receive a call, we have to once verify it, and once we have verified and the disaster has been declared, then when we send the EMS people, we have to be in constant touch from the ED to the scene to see what is happening. It's not just like a one-time communication, a constant flow of communication should be required. And while that is done, the idea is all about forming teams, control and command system, wherein we control the situation, anticipate the challenges, and we allot specific roles so chaos and confusion
can be avoided
at a later date. And also for the judicious use of resources, we should know the capacity of what we can handle and what we cannot, knowing our limitations.
So the most important thing why we never had any major chaos was that we had a very good disaster preparedness. So the key aspect, as again and again I will say, in a disaster cycle will be the disaster preparedness. So can you just elaborate the disaster cycle?
So in the disaster cycle, basically we have to always be prepared. Disaster preparedness will always be the first step. And once with the disaster preparedness is done and the disaster has been declared, the second would be our response to the disaster, how we're going to deal with this, which we dealt with. And then will be the recovery and the rehabilitation, wherein we provide the patient with psychiatric rehabilitation or any physical rehabilitation if need be. And the next part would be the mitigation. And then once this whole thing is done, again we have to prepare the patient.
So the priority you have, whichever hospital center you are working, you should know what are the anticipated things. Suppose we are very closely into a railway station here. So we are anytime we are just thinking in that we need to receive some patients following an accident. So there is a very heavy national highway. We were never expecting a fire incident. We were expecting something else, but we received something else. So that is always there. So whichever hospital you are working, you should have a clear-cut hospital disaster management plan. And make sure that you are doing at least a mock drill every 6 months. So once you are doing a mock drill every 6 months, we have been doing this mock drill for the last so many years, and we know that these things will happen. So we were doing dummy patients with all those things, but when genuinely we can't exactly say as a mass casualty in this, because our capacity is 50, we received only 12 patients. So we can't exactly, but our capacity was full. Already during that time, that capacity, ED capacity was full. But still we can say maybe a multiple casualty we received. But we managed it reasonably well so that the patient was saved. So the priority will be for our disaster preparedness. That will be the key at the end of the session.
Because at the point, there is no point in planning. So
suppose we never had any plan in our mind. There is no code yellow. Whom to call? We need to sit on the telephone and we need to call all those members. We need to call the blood bank. We need to call the CT room. Everyone, we need to keep ringing them. So here it was, everything was planned. So in all a just tech phone call, everybody was ready. And they were very clear on their responsibility also. They were clear what to do. What should be their role in the when a disaster happens. Okay.
So that's how we paged yellow the other day.
Okay. Fine.
That's about it. So.
Fine. Thank you.